Assalamu alaikum and bismillah rahman rahim. With the name of Allah, we will start our session. First of all, I would like to thank SOGP Pakistan that they have discussed and they have formulated this important forum to discuss a very important cause, PPH. PPH is still a nightmare for all the gynecologists. So in the start, I am very lucky and I am very thankful, and it's a pleasure and honor for me that I have to moderate this August forum on this PPH topic. First of all, I would like to give a brief introduction. My all panelists have a huge and very heavy introductions, so I will just touch their names and a brief introduction. First of all, Madam Professor Razia Qureshi, she is the President of Society of Gynae and Obs Pakistan. Madam is a very pleasant and soft personality, as we all know, and she is an ex-professor of Obs and Gynae, JPMC, Karachi. Presently, Professor Razia Qureshi is at Behria University and Medical and Dental College, Karachi. So I will now request to the Sami Pharmaceutical to just give the slides and video of Madam introduction. Sami Pharmaceutical, please. Mr. Rubes.
SOGP members, healthcare providers, speakers, panelists, chairperson, and moderator. Assalamu alaikum. On behalf of the Society of Obstetricians and Gynecologists of Pakistan, I welcome you all today in this very important webinar, which is on postpartum hemorrhage and its management. As all of you know, that PPH is the leading cause of maternal mortality in Pakistan. And it has been increasing since decades. While we are conducting all the workshops on postpartum management or postpartum hemorrhage, but still it is going to be increasing. As all of you know, that the PPH has a multiple etiology, and it has a multidisciplinary team for its arrest of the bleeding and the hemostasis. So this is because SOGP has been working since decades in order to improve the knowledge and skill of the healthcare providers. For this, we have continuously conducting workshops on management of the postpartum hemorrhage since decades, but still we are not getting the reduction of the maternal mortality due to the postpartum hemorrhage. So this workshop will also, I hope this workshop will help you all today in order to increase your knowledge and improve your skill development. Our SOGP has been organized workshops on EMOC services. So this is also in continuation of the same. All the team speakers and the panelists are very dedicated, very experienced. They will tell you about this management of the postpartum hemorrhage. As all of you know, that when the postpartum hemorrhage occurs within 2 hours, if you have not given the adequate treatment, then you will lose the patients. So I request all of you to please, whoever does the deliveries and do the antenatal care, please find out the risk factors of the postpartum hemorrhage and refer them to appropriate centers where all the multidisciplinary team is there. So, and the prevention is also better than cure. So prevention of the postpartum hemorrhage is very useful. So you have to identify the risk factors and do the active management of the third stage of the labor, they will reduce the postpartum hemorrhage. Today we have called very experienced moderator, who is the Naila Star, and the panelist, Dr. Huma Kudus, and the Arisa Watar. And the chairperson is Dr. Rubina Sahel, and the speaker is Dr. Shahida Tahir, from the disaster side and her team. So I hope they will conduct a very good workshop. They are very dedicated, very experienced, very committed doctors of SLDP. So I am thankful to all of them for giving their valuable time for today's webinar. I hope everyone will benefit from today's webinar. And we hope that we will reduce, our aim is to improve the maternal health, to reduce the maternal mortality.
Madam, thank you, Madam Razia Kareju. We are really, our SOGP is really flourishing under your kind supervision. I welcome to Professor Halima Yasmeen on this webinar. Professor Halima Yasmeen is a professor at JPMC Karachi. She's a Secretary General of SOGP, a very academic personality. She had conducted all the academic activities in this era of pandemic, COVID-19. She had pushed a lot to all the gynecologists just in whole Pakistan. I welcome you, Professor Halima Yasmeen. Our next panelist is Professor Rubina Suhail, and she's our chairperson also, and she needs no introduction. But I would just, it's an honor for me that I would like to say a few words about Madam Professor Rubina Suhail. She's an ex-member of SOGP, executive member of SOGP. She's a consultant of ops and gynecology at Hamid Latif Hospital, and also expert and master of the sexual and reproductive health. She had written books on the rights of the woman and right on the sexual and reproductive health rights. She's a past president of CEFO, and widely published international articles in international and national journals like Lancet. And she's author of many books and chapters. She was awarded by the Young Gynecologist Award in 1995. She had joined us from Lahore. Our next panelist is Professor Huma Quddusi. She's executive member of Society of Gynae Obs Pakistan, a very academic person. And she's playing a leading role in her area, which is a Multan. And we can just think that what type of casualties and how much PPH she must be handling and treating. So thank you, Madam Professor Huma Quddusi. Professor Farisa Bakkar, a renowned gynecologist. Madam had joined us from Rawalpindi. She's a leading name in Rawalpindi and Islamabad. Her degrees are MBBS, MCPS, FCPS, and MHPE. She also holds a diploma in lifestyle medicine. She's a professor and head of department at Rifai University, supervisors of MS exam, MCPS, FCPS. She's a co-chairperson of SOGP Rawalpindi and Islamabad. Madam has also many publication, international and national, in her account. So welcome, Professor Farisa Bakkar. She also runs a very popular course, preparatory course of Part 2 in Rawalpindi and Islamabad. The most beautiful, I must say, Professor Shahida, ye tareef aapko hamesha milti hai, with a good, pretty smile and pretty dimple. Professor Shahida Hussain Tarar holds the Certificate of Health Professional Education from Shifa University. She's Associate Professor working at Nawaz Sharif Medical College, Gujarat, Chairperson SOGP Gujarat, and Examiner of Undergraduate and Postgraduate Students. She's a focal person of Punjab AIDS Program of Pregnant Mother, focal person of NCMNH, and she had made SOGP viable and very active in Gujarat. All credit goes to Professor Shahida Hussain Tarar, and she is our speaker of today also. She's also author of many research papers. And lastly, I'm Naila Star, working as a head of department at Federal Government Polyclinic Islamabad, executive member of SOGP Islamabad. And it is an honor and pleasure for me and the biggest introduction that I'm a moderator of this August forum. So welcome to you all. So now we will start our session, Madam Professor Shahida Hussain Tarar, with your presentation and the videos. Mr. Awais, can you hear me, please?
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you clearly, but as you announced, this is, I think, the slot for Dr. Shahida Hussain.
Ji.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Naila. Thank you for your kind introduction. And this is indeed an honor and a pleasure for me to be part of this, I must say, esteemed panel of consultants. And I feel humbled to be part of this panel. And this is indeed my pride moment that I am talking as a keynote speaker on this important webinar. Today's webinar is about postpartum hemorrhage. We have planned this webinar in a way that from SOGP Gujarat chapter, I will be giving that keynote talk, and it would be followed by two skill demonstrations by my faculty members, and those faculty members would be performing certain maneuvers and skills so that we can assure that how we can manage postpartum hemorrhage and what are the skills needed for all healthcare providers who can control PPH by doing those skills. I would start with my presentation. I'm sharing the screen. Can we see the screen?
Yes,
we all can.
We can see.
Okay. I start with a prayer, with a supplication that I may be able to convey what I need to convey. And I hope that everybody understands that, what are we trying to emphasize today. The postpartum hemorrhage is a common yet a fatal complication of pregnancy. And we need to know the causes, the predisposing factors, the measures to prevent it, and the measures to treat it when it occurs. It is still one of the biggest nightmares of every obstetrician if her patient starts bleeding after her delivery. And that those few moments or few minutes of time are extremely crucial to save the life of that mother. And we all must know what to do in those crucial circumstances. I'm thankful to SOGP for providing this platform that we are about to discuss the very important and very pressing challenge, which is still a very huge challenge for all of us. And we need to do drastic measures to improve the skills and the learning methods. Postpartum hemorrhage is a common complication, as I said. And the other problem is that we actually underestimate it. There is a gap in the estimation. We cannot actually assess the amount of blood loss which is going on. And we must realize that the visual assessment of blood loss may not be accurate, and the patient might be losing a lot of blood, and we might realize it a little later when the patient starts going into hypovolemic shock. And we have to do things before the patient goes into irreversible shock. So our best estimate is still a gross underestimate. We have to realize this thing. Another thing that we need to realize is that it is not essential that a patient might have a predisposing factor and only she will have a postpartum hemorrhage. Actually, all pregnancies are at a risk of potential postpartum hemorrhage. So our best preparation is anticipation. We have to anticipate. We have to keep our reflexes alert, and we have to anticipate that every delivery can end up in postpartum hemorrhage, and immediate measures need to be done in order to save the life of that woman, even if there is no predisposing factor. This is an old survey. Unfortunately, we do not get a lot of surveys done in Pakistan, but this survey still holds true that postpartum hemorrhage accounts for about 1/4 of all the maternal deaths which occur. It is the leading cause of maternal mortality. It accounts for 27% of maternal deaths. This survey was done in 2007. And I'm sure Dr. Ubina and other worthy panelists would vouch that this still holds true. And still, postpartum hemorrhage is still accounting for the biggest number of deaths after delivery. So about 3 to 5% of obstetric patients will experience postpartum hemorrhage, and these are most frequently preventable causes. And we need to do measures to prevent, and we need to do measures to best possibly treat these patients. What are the two types of postpartum hemorrhage? By definition, postpartum hemorrhage can be primary postpartum hemorrhage in a normal vaginal delivery, a loss of 500 ml or more from the genital tract within 24 hours after birth of a baby would be labeled as primary postpartum hemorrhage. Whereas secondary postpartum hemorrhage is abnormal or excessive bleeding from the birth canal after 24 hours, but within 12 weeks postnatally. In some books and in some definitions, this postnatal period has been confined to 6 weeks. And in some other books, this postnatal period is 12 weeks. So secondary would be after 24 hours and extending up to 12 weeks postnatally. This is the WHO definition, that PPH is defined as blood loss greater than or equal to 500 ml within 24 hours after birth, while severe PPH is blood loss greater than or equal to 1000 milliliters within 24 hours. The diagram below shows the periods of gestation at which hemorrhage can occur. After the age of viability till the delivery of the baby, this would be labeled as antepartum hemorrhage. Within 24 hours, it would be labeled as primary postpartum hemorrhage. And after 24 hours, up to 6 weeks, according to WHO definition, would be labeled as secondary postpartum hemorrhage. This is the diagrammatic representation of the events that occur when the postpartum hemorrhage occurs. What are the parts of the body, or what are the parts of the reproductive tract that can bleed and that can lead to postpartum hemorrhage? Obviously, the largest organ is uterus itself. The uterus itself at the time of delivery or at the full-term pregnancy is having a large amount of blood flowing through its blood vessels. And if it starts bleeding, it can lead to massive amount of hemorrhage within very few minutes. So the largest organ or the largest area which can bleed is the uterus itself, and it would bleed if it is uncontracted. If the uterus contracts, which is the normal physiological response of the body after the delivery of the baby, when the placenta separates, the uterus contracts. If the uterus contracts, the blood vessels present in the uterus get closed down and the uterus does not bleed. But if due to any reason the uterus does not contract, those blood vessels or the sinuses would remain open and they would pour massive amounts of blood into the uterine cavity, as we can see in this picture. Sometimes the placenta is not fully detached from the uterine wall and it is partly adherent or partly attached to the uterus and partly detached. Even then, it would lead to collection of large amount of blood in the uterine cavity and large amount of hemorrhage. In some other cases, there can be injuries to the genital tract, injuries to the uterus itself, injuries to the cervix, and injuries to the vagina and perineum. They would also lead, and they can also lead to large amounts of hemorrhage, and they are also cause of postpartum hemorrhage in some other cases. So coming to the risk factors, what are the risk factors of postpartum hemorrhage? The risk factors of postpartum hemorrhage are the patient who has undergone antepartum hemorrhage is more likely to have postpartum hemorrhage because the antepartum hemorrhage would lead to spillage or exsanguination of blood into the uterine muscle, and the uterine muscle would be less likely to contract after the delivery. In patients who have undergone augmented labor, they are more likely to have postpartum hemorrhage as compared to the patients who have delivered through spontaneous labor. In the presence of chorioamnionitis, the risk increases. Similarly, in the presence of fetal macrosomia or any other condition which leads to over-distension of the uterus is more likely to remain uncontracted or atonic, and the patient is more likely to have postpartum hemorrhage. Maternal anemia is a great problem in our community and in our population. And we have seen that the patients who are anemic are more likely to have postpartum hemorrhage, one thing, because their cellular functions are compromised because of anemia, and the myometrial fibers, the smooth muscle fibers of the uterus, are less likely to contract effectively in the presence of anemia. And number two, because maternal anemia would worsen the effects of even a smaller blood loss as compared to a patient who is not anemic. She might be able to withstand a large hemorrhage, but a patient who is anemic will not be able to withstand even a smaller hemorrhage. So maternal anemia needs to be addressed and prevented as much as possible. The other risk factors include maternal obesity, multifetal gestation, preeclampsia, more likely in primary paras, and also more likely in grand multiparas, and in patients who have been in labor for a very long period of time. They are more likely because the uterine muscle fibers get exhausted in a prolonged labor. If we want to classify or we want to divide the causes of postpartum hemorrhage into subgroups, a very easy to remember mnemonic is 4 T's. These 4 T's are uterine tone, trauma to the uterus or lower genital tract, retained tissue or invasive placenta, and to a very small extent, the coagulopathies, which are denoted by thrombin. So we can see the different distribution of these causes. 70% of the cases are because of atonic uterus, whereas 20% of the cases are because of trauma, either to the upper genital tract or to the lower genital tract. It would include the lacerations. It also includes the hematomas, which might not be obvious easily, but these hematomas can accommodate a large amount of blood, and patients can collapse and go into hypovolemic or irreversible shock if not diagnosed in time. Uterine inversion, fortunately, is becoming less common because of better methods of placental delivery, but still we see sometimes uterine inversion if the delivery has been conducted by a birth attendant who is not trained in the delivery of the placenta. And uterine rupture, we still see, unfortunately, I belong to an area where we see a large number of patients coming from the periphery after the delivery, and after a lot of time has passed, still a number of people are delivering at home or in the facilities where all the birth attendants are not skilled in the art of delivery, and we still see uterine rupture in our hospital, and we still see a large number of mortality and morbidity because of uterine rupture. Detained tissues and invasive placenta are 10%, and coagulopathies, either acquired or congenital, account for 1% of these cases. Now, coming to the tone of the uterus, as we already saw, that over-distended uterus, exhausted myometrial wall or myometrial tissue, intra-amniotic infection, or functional or anatomic distortion of the uterus. It might be because of fibroid uterus. It might be because of bicornuate uterus. So any distortion in the anatomy of the uterus might lead to atony. So these are the common causes of atonic uterus. Then we come to the causes of PPH because of trauma. And that trauma can be in the cervix vagina perineum. It can be extension of the cesarean incision. It can be a uterine rupture. Might be a patient might not be having previous uterine incision or scar, but still uterine rupture can occur if injudicious use of fentanyl has been done and excessive fundal pressure, as we still see in some cases, has been given. I recently saw a patient, a young primary para, who was delivered outside the hospital, and she was a primary gravida and she had an extensive rupture of the uterus, and her repair of her uterus was really a marathon job. And we still see sometimes the cases of uterine inversion. So these are the causes of trauma, and which account for 20% of the postpartum hemorrhage. 10% of the postpartum hemorrhage is because of the retained placental tissue, as we already saw. It can be retained placenta. It can be abnormally adherent placenta. Some bits and pieces of membranes can cause it. Sometimes a partially low-lying placenta can be there. Sometimes there is just an accessory cotyledon of placenta or only blood clots which prevent uterine contraction and which do not allow the uterus to contract fully, or the uterus contracts and then relaxes. There is intermittent contraction and relaxation of uterus. And the last but not the least, we have to keep in mind that sometimes patient might be a case of coagulopathy. It might be an inherited or acquired coagulopathy, or sometimes it can be because of anticoagulants or some other drugs have been used and they have led to coagulopathy, and the patient might continue to bleed despite the absence of all these other causes. What is the clinical picture or clinical scenario that patient has delivered? After the delivery of the baby and after the delivery of the placenta, there is still visible bleeding there. There is maternal collapse. Her pulse rate is rising and her blood pressure is falling. She is pale, cold, sweaty, clammy. She might be having altered level of consciousness, and on per abdominal examination, which must always be done after the delivery of the placenta, we must see a contracted and a relatively smaller uterus, but in these cases, we might be seeing an enlarged and a boggy uterus. So how are we going to manage this postpartum hemorrhage? Please remember, and I'm sure this cannot be emphasized enough, that this is not a job of a single person. This is a teamwork, and all the team members have to be sensitized and mobilized if we are anticipating postpartum hemorrhage or we are heading towards postpartum hemorrhage. We have to involve appropriate colleagues, whoever are available to us, the midwife in charge, the team of midwives, even their students. We have to call our senior obstetricians. We have to inform the anesthetist. We have to inform the blood bank. We have to involve the hematologist if available. And we have to inform our ancillary staff, that is the porters who are going to shift the patient if needed to the operation theater. Communication between the team and documentation is very, very important. And it cannot be emphasized enough that a good communication and diligent documentation is vital. At the same time, while we are involving the team and while we are alerting our team, we have to send certain investigations and we have to start monitoring that patient. Respiratory rate, oxygen saturation, heart rate, blood pressure, temperature every 15 minutes. And we have to think about catheterization of that patient. Catheter of the patient would help us in two ways. It would empty the bladder, which might facilitate contraction of the uterus, because uterus sometimes does not contract in the presence of a full bladder. And the catheterization would also help in monitoring the intake and output of that patient, which is vital if the patient is going towards hypovolemic shock. We might need to insert a central venous line, so we have to alert our intensive care team and our anesthesia colleagues as well. Prevention is much better than cure, we all know. And how can we prevent PPH? Antenatally, we have to prevent PPH. We can prevent by preventing anemia. If anemia is there, we have to treat it. Small family size, we should educate our patients towards small family size. Population control is very, very important because we still see Gravida 8, Gravida 9, Gravida 7 patients, and they are much more likely to have adverse outcomes during delivery and after delivery. Multiple pregnancies, we cannot actually prevent, but we can diagnose. And if we have diagnosed, we can take necessary measures to assist that patient and to prevent her postpartum hemorrhage. Obesity, if antenatally or before pregnancy, if we see a patient who has a high BMI, we can always tell her to reduce her weight before she becomes pregnant. Polyhydramnios and low-lying placenta can also be diagnosed in the antenatal period. Intrapartum, very important things that need to be done are the active management of third stage of labor. We will discuss it in the next slide. But that is actually the key factor in managing or preventing postpartum hemorrhage. So we will discuss it in detail. And in postpartum period, we have to monitor for ongoing bleed. We have to assess for the blood loss and the anemia that has resulted. And we have to provide psychological support, debrief the patient, her husband, and our team. The pharmacological agents that are used in the postpartum hemorrhage and even in the management of third stage of labor are oxytocin. Oxytocin should be given 10 international units intramuscular at the delivery of anterior shoulder or 5 international units flow IV in case of C-section. Tranexamic acid is becoming very important part of the management of third stage of labor, and 1 gram intravenous tranexamic acid can prevent a large number of postpartum hemorrhages. If oxytocin is not effective or not available, we can use oxytocin plus ergometrine, syntrometrine. Misoprostol once again plays a very important role, and 800 microgram per rectal misoprostol can prevent postpartum hemorrhage to a great extent. So what is active management of third stage of labor? Oxytocin at the delivery of anterior shoulder, early cord clamping, and controlled cord traction. These are the 3 components of active management of third stage of labor. By controlled cord traction, we mean that one hand is placed on the suprapubic part of the body, suprapubic part of abdomen, and it presses the uterus upwards, whereas the other hand gently and slowly pulls the cord downward after the signs of separation of placenta have been elicited, only then. And this would prevent the uterine inversion and it would prevent the uterine atony as well. Once again, this is the severity slide. It is a repetition. This slide is important because we cannot actually measure the blood loss quantitatively. It is just a visual assessment of blood loss, and we must be aware that this visual assessment can be misleading, and we might be missing a large amount of blood which is being absorbed into the gauze pieces or the cotton packs or the sterile pads or the patient's sheets. So we must realize that we have to take into account all the blood which is being lost. These are the visual or the pictorial assessment of blood loss. That one small clot is 30 ml. If a gauze piece is partly soaked, this is 50 ml. If it is fully soaked, this is 200 ml. Then if a cotton pad is soaked in the center, this is 100 ml. And if a cotton pad is fully soaked, this is 300 ml. If the patient is soaking her sheets and her clothes, her blood loss is possibly more than 1000 ml of blood. This is the protocol which is given by Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. And this algorithm actually helps us in jotting down or making sure that we are not missing anything. First and foremost is call for help. Very important. This cannot be done by one or two persons. We need more than two persons here. We have to put the patient in a lying position. She should lie supine in a comfortable position, and we have to start massaging the uterus. Uterine massage can result in contraction of the uterus, and it can stop the excess bleeding which is going on. At the same time, the other person who is with us, he will start passing two IV cannulas with a large bore. And while we are passing the cannula, we will take blood samples for baseline investigations and for cross-match. And that cross-match sample would be sent to the blood bank. And blood bank should be informed telephonically or verbally that this patient might need blood transfusion. And her blood must be arranged on a priority basis. Meanwhile, while we have passed the IV lines, we have to start rapid IV replacement of fluid. And this rapid IV replacement of fluids would be by crystalloids. Crystalloids, normal saline or lactated ringer should be started. And 1,000 to 1,500 ml of normal saline or ringer lactate should be given quickly. We will check the status of the patient. We will check the stats, the respiratory rate, the pulse rate, the blood pressure. And we will assess we will continue assessing the blood loss. And then we have to identify the cause by checking all those four T's. We have to look for the tone of the uterus. We have to look for any trauma. We have to look for any retained pieces of placenta. We have to try to stop the bleeding. In order to stop the bleeding, we will give oxytocin 10 units or ergometrine 500 micrograms if ergometrine is not contraindicated, because we know that ergometrine is contraindicated in cardiac patients with cardiac failure, and we will not be giving ergometrine or to hypertensive patients as well. So we will not be giving ergometrine to the patients in which it is contraindicated. Transamic acid 1 gram IV stat should be given to stop the bleeding. We can start oxytocin infusion 40 units in 4 hours. We can dilute oxytocin 40 units in 500 cc of normal saline, and it should be given over a period of 4 hours. We will catheterize the patient. Carboprost, if available, is a good choice. 250 microgram intramuscular every 15 minutes up to 8 doses can be given according to the recommendation of WHO. But unfortunately, we do not have carboprost available with us. We have a very good alternative, that is misoprostol, and we have seen misoprostol doing wonders in our patients. Misoprostol given per rectally does initiate uterine contraction, and it really helps. Continuing with the RCOG protocol, we will continue the massage of the uterus and continue bimanual compression of the uterus. And at the same time, we will examine the perineum, vagina, and the cervix for any tears or lacerations. And if they are there, they should be sutured immediately. Next, we will continue the assessment of the patient. We will chart our observations on critical care chart. We will monitor the time. We will monitor the blood loss. And we will monitor the fluid balance. Once again, if blood loss is still continuing, we will reassess that we have not missed anything in those four T's. And second dose of transamic acid can be given in this second phase of management. Here comes the role of blood transfusion, blood products, invasive monitoring, ABGs, and assessment of the hemoglobin of the patient or hematocrit of the patient. So this is the continuous assessment of the patient, which is an ongoing process. One important thing is the obstetrical shock index. if it is calculated by dividing the heart rate over the systolic blood pressure. If the heart rate exceeds the systolic blood pressure, the obstetrical shock index comes out to be more than one. Suppose the patient is having a pulse rate of 100 beats per minute and her blood pressure is 70 millimeters of mercury, systolic blood pressure, her shock index would become more than one. So this shock index, if it is more than one, it is going to predict an adverse clinical outcome. It would mean that the patient is going in the hypovolemic shock and her resuscitation or other measures might be needed in order to control the hemorrhage. Obstetrical emergencies do not happen often, but when they do, seconds matter. Everyone has to act together as quickly as possible. We have to anticipate the possible problem. We have to think in advance. We have to be assertive. We cannot just keep our volumes low in such conditions because we have to make sure that everybody hears us and everybody registers what we are asking for. We have to make sure that the others know the importance of this emergency. This is the recap of that general management of RCUG. Then we come to the surgical measures which might be needed in such cases. If the medical measures are not working, we may have to go for surgical measures. The surgical measures include uterine packing is no longer done and it is no longer recommended because of the risk of infection and because uterine packing sometimes is not done as effectively as it should be and the patient might continue to lose blood despite uterine packing. So we do not actually do uterine packing now. But balloon tamponade is a very, very helpful and a very important measure which acts just as uterine packing should do, that it would compress the uterine cavity from the inside and it would stop the bleeding from the open sinuses of the uterus. Then another very important and very helpful measure is the Beelin suture. Beelin suture has really changed the scenario of atonic hemorrhage and we are saving a large number of patients who are having atonic uterus by Beelin suture without having to resort to classical or cesarean hysterectomy. Stepwise devascularization of the blood vessels supplying the uterine cavity, supplying the genital tract, includes the uterine artery ligation and internal iliac ligation. First and foremost, in the labor room, we can start by doing bimanual uterine massage. Bimanual uterine massage is done by the obstetrician while putting one hand in the vagina, in the anterior fornix of vagina, and putting the other hand on the abdomen and compressing the uterus, anterior and posterior wall of the uterus between our two hands. Bimanual uterine massage seems to have great effects in reducing hemorrhage and it also initiates the contraction of the uterus and stops postpartum hemorrhage. If bimanual massage is not working, and sometimes it is not practically possible because sometimes we have very obese patients and their bimanual massage sometimes become a little tricky. In those patients, we go for the balloon tamponade of the uterine cavity. A very effective and a purpose-built balloon has been devised by Bakri, but we do not have the Bakri balloon catheters with us. They are not cost-effective and they are not easily available, so we have managed to make some makeshift arrangements in order to mimic this Bakri balloon and that results in balloon tamponade. In balloon tamponade, we inflate a balloon inside the uterine cavity and that compresses the whole of the inside of the uterine cavity and it stops the bleeding. This is the diagrammatic representation of the atony of the uterus. The contracted blood vessels in the second picture they remain open and they do not close down, and the blood keeps accumulating in the uterine cavity, whereas the contracted blood vessels, contracted uterine muscles, result in closing down the blood vessels and stopping the hemorrhage. If balloon tamponade is not effective, then we have to resort to the compression sutures or Beal-Lynch sutures. For this, we have to shift the patient to the operation theater, because the compression sutures or Beal-Lynch sutures will not be done in the labor room. And the preparation for shifting the patient, if her bleeding is not controlled, should already have been made, and the patient is going to be shifted to the operation theater. These are the two types of Beal-Lynch sutures or brace sutures or compression sutures. This is the Beal-Lynch suture, and the other is the Heymann suture. And these sutures effectively compress the uterine walls, and they result in arrest of bleeding. Fortunately, we had Professor Beal-Lynch here in Pakistan, in Islamabad, Dr. Farisha Wakar. We can see you in this picture, and Dr. Saira as well. We were very fortunate to have Professor Beal-Lynch here for a 2 days workshop, and he taught us hands-on by teaching every one of us how to perform a Beal-Lynch suture. And this was a memorable workshop which we always remember. And he has really innovated and really made a great change in the management of postpartum hemorrhage, because these sutures are uterine conserving sutures. By performing these sutures, we have been able to save the uterus of many, many patients. And we are fortunate that this great professor was here and he taught us with his own hands. If Beal-Lynch suture is not working or the brace sutures are not working, then we will have to resort to the stepwise devascularization of the uterus, in which we ligate the uterine artery. We ligate as many branches of the uterine arteries which we might be able to see. And sometimes we have to ligate the anterior division of internal iliac artery as well. All of us must be trained, and we must train our juniors, our postgraduates and senior registrars in identifying the internal iliac artery and the ability to ligate it if necessary. This might save a lot of patients as well. How do we manage these risks? All of these risks, all the obstetrical emergencies, can be managed only and only if we practice them regularly and we practice the drills regularly. If we are not practicing the drills frequently, repeatedly, in a systematic way, we will lose the skill, because these emergencies do not happen every day. But when they happen, they do not allow us much time. So we have to keep doing the drills. It is the method of practicing the management of an obstetrical emergency in facilities where emergency obstetrical care is delivered. So PPS drills should be mandatory for all healthcare providers. And we all wish that all healthcare providers, we can reach them and we can teach them the PPS drills and the drills of other obstetrical emergencies. How do we optimize the PPS management? That every maternity unit should have multidisciplinary protocol for PPS management. All the staff involved in maternity care should receive training in managing obstetrical emergencies, including PPH. The training of PPH should be multi-professional and should include team rehearsals. This is very, very important, that these drills or rehearsals have to be a continuous process. All cases of PPH with blood loss more than 1500 ml should be subject to formal clinical incident review. Accurate documentation of a delivery with PPH is absolutely necessary. We have to debrief the women and her partner about the event, and we have to debrief our own team about things that were done and the things that were not done or could have been done and were not done in time. We have to talk about every such event in detail with our own team as well. These are the references of the slides that I have presented. These were from Green Top Guidelines, the WHO recommendations for the prevention and treatment of postpartum hemorrhage, and the Women 2 trial as well. With this, I come to the end of my presentation. I thank you all for the patient listening, and I would hand over the mic now to the moderator of the session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Shahida Tahrir. You elaborated in a very excellent way that what is PPH and how we can prevent the PPH. But sometimes the deaths of the PPH are so horrible that we cannot erase them from our mind. Just a few months earlier, we received a patient who was bleeding at home after home delivery, and the relative said, "Do ghante pehle usne baat karni chhod di." So practically, she was dead 2 ghante pehle, and she was brought dead to our hospital. So helplessness at that time is really very difficult. Thank you, Professor Shahida. Before proceeding to the next video, I would love to welcome Professor Aftab Munir, who had joined us in this forum. Madam, I'm really humbled that you spended your precious time to join this webinar. Professor Ghazala Mahmood, she's a leader and teacher of the teachers. Madam, you have joined this forum. I'm really humbled. I say welcome to you, Dr. Amtul Zareen, and to all other my dear and respected participants. One name is Dr. Sayed Ahmed Ali. I welcome to this male gynecology participant also. Now next, Shahida, we will move to the videos or the skill by your department. Skill demonstration of balloon tamponade and intrauterine packing by Dr. Ikra Arshad, Dr. Sadaf Iftikhar, and Rizwana Khalid. These all doctors are from the faculty of Gujarat under kind supervision of Professor Shahida Hussain Tahrir.
Now we are going to demonstrate balloon tamponade, which is very effective and useful technique to treat postpartum hemorrhage when other pharmacological measures fail to control PPH. Its main principle is to exert tamponade effect on uterine walls to stop bleeding in non-traumatic postpartum hemorrhage. Before applying balloon tamponade, we should rule out its contraindication. We should look for any vaginal or cervical trauma, any retained products of conception, suspected uterine rupture, any vaginal infection, fibroid, or any anomaly of uterus causing distortion of uterine cavity, or any allergy to balloon material. Equipment required is sterile gloves, adult size Foley's catheter, condom, silk suture number 1, bladder wash syringe or drip set, 1 liter normal saline, any good light source, kidney tray, and sponge holding forceps. And ultrasound machine can also be taken. Before applying balloon tamponade, put patient in lithotomy position and ensure adequate light exposures and sterilization. Then empty bladder and take adult size Foley's catheter fitted with condom and tie its lower end with silk suture 1. Now we are going to demonstrate how to fit Foley's catheter with condom and tie its lower end. The tie should not be too loose, nor too tight, otherwise it can obstruct the lumen of catheter if it is too tight. And if it is too loose, then it can cause backflow of fluid. Then retract the posterior vaginal wall and hold the anterior lip of cervix. Retract the posterior vaginal wall and fold anterior lip of cervix with sponge holding forceps and insert the catheter fitted with condom inside the uterine cavity, taking it to the fundus, ideally ultrasound guided. Now inflate the bladder catheter with normal saline. Usually 250 to 300 ml saline is filled with the help of bladder wash syringe and clamp the lower end of catheter to prevent the backflow. Now you can see in model that balloon has been inflated. We will keep it in situ for next 24 hours. There is another which is more easy and practical, in which we take drip set fitted with condom and tie its lower end of condom with silk suture one. Then again retract the posterior vaginal wall and insert the drip set fitted with condom inside the uterine cavity and ask assistant to push the saline which will fill the condom under effect of gravity. Usually 350 to 400 ml normal saline can be filled and this will exert the tamponade effect on uterine walls and stop bleeding. Then ligate lower end of drip set to prevent the backflow. And again, we will keep it in situ for next 24 hours. After applying tamponade, we will reposition patient and cover her, shift her to recovery room and write down detailed notes along with time and date. Now you can see on model that balloon has been inflated with saline and this will exert pressure on uterine walls and stop bleed. After applying balloon tamponade, we will reposition patient, cover her, shift her to recovery room and write down detailed notes along with time and date. And during post-op period, we will monitor her vitals hourly for next 6 to 12 hours, check her fundal height, vagina bleeding, maintain input-output record, give broad-spectrum IV antibiotics, and start simple Sinon infusion for next 24 hours. Thank you.
B Lynch is the brace suture applied to atonic uterus. It is an innovative, simple fertility and uterus sparing technique. It was first time described in 1997 by Christopher Lynch. There are certain indications. Number one, uterine atony, placenta previa, placental abruption, coelial uterus. In patients where all other conservative and medical treatments are failed, as prophylactically used in patients more prone for primary postpartum hemorrhage, for example, high multiples, over-distended uterus in twins, where uterus has to be conserved. Suture material, we need absorbable sutures such as catheter number 2 or Vicryl number 1, 70 mm round body needle. whether how to perform balloon suture. Steps of procedure is number one, exteriorize the uterus. Number two, check the efficacy of balloon suture by compressing the uterus between the palms of the both hands. Suture use is tactic number two or vital number one. Now start applying the suture. A point is 3 centimeters below the lower edge of incision, which is 3 centimeters medial to the lateral border of uterus. Come out 3 centimeters above the upper edge of incision, which is 4 centimeters medial to lateral border of uterus. Cross over the fundus and pass the needle on the posterior wall of the uterus at the level of anterior incision like this. Then again cross over the uterus fundus. Again cross over the fundus of the uterus. Repeat the suture. Anteriorly 3 centimeters above the upper edge of incision. And again 3 centimeters below the lower edge of incision. Now pull the thread maximum to squeeze the uterus. Tie the knot anteriorly below the uterine incision. Cut the thread and close the uterine incision in 2 layers. Replace the uterus in the abdominal cavity. Check for the vaginal bleeding. Close the abdomen in reverse order. Complete sponge and instrument count. B-Lynch is a brace suture applied to atonic uterus. It is an innovative, simple fertility and uterus sparing technique. It was first time described in 1997 by Christopher Lynch. There are certain indications. Number one, uterine atony, placenta previa, placental abruption, coiliar uterus. In patients where all other conservative and medical treatments are failed, as prophylactically used in patients more prone for primary postpartum hemorrhage, for example, high multiples, over-distended uterus in twins, where uterus has to be conserved. Suture material, we need absorbable sutures such as catheter number 2 or vital number 1, 70 mm round body needle. Method, how to perform B-Lynch. Steps of procedure. Number 1, exteriorize the uterus. Number 2, check the efficacy of the B-Lynch by compressing the uterus between the palm of both hands. Suture use is catheter number 2, vital number 1. Now start applying the suture 3 cm below the lower edge of incision, which is 3 cm medial to the lateral border of uterus. And come out 3 cm above the upper edge of incision. It is 4 cm medial to the lateral border of uterus. Cross over the fundus, the needle on the posterior wall of uterus at the level of anterior incision, like this. Now again, cross over the fundus. Again, cross over the fundus. Repeat the suture anteriorly 3 cm above the upper edge of incision. And 3 cm below the lower edge of incision. Pull the thread maximum to squeeze the uterus. Tie the knots anteriorly below the uterine incision. Cut the thread. And then close the uterine incision in 2 layers. Replace the uterus in the abdominal cavity. Check for vaginal bleeding. Close the abdomen in reverse order. Complete sponge and instrument count. Start killing. There's an adjustment. There are certain modifications in Behlen's suture. Modified Behlen's. Modified Behlen's suture is the adaptation of the Behlen's suture that is performed without giving the uterine incision when the patient has delivered vaginally. In modified Behlen's suture, 2 vertical compression sutures are placed as needed. But in contrast to Behlen's technique, these sutures pass directly from the anterior uterine wall to the posterior uterine wall. Ask the assistant to hold it with artery forceps. Tied up simultaneously while asking the assistant to squeeze the uterus. Now replace the uterus in the abdominal cavity, check for vaginal bleeding, close the abdomen in reverse order, complete sponge and instrument count. Post-procedure care. Monitor the vitals of the patients, blood pressure, pulse, temperature, respiratory rate in post-op care. Ward. Continue oxytocin infusion for 12 to 24 hours. Give antibiotic cover. Complications, failure of procedure, ischemic necrosis, pyometra, injury to the surrounding vistas, cervical stenosis, Asherman syndrome.
Thank you, Faculty of Gujarat, Professor Shahida Hussain Taradeh. It was really a wonderful demonstration by your faculty. They did very well. Excellent models they made. It seems very easy while we are watching a video, but practically when we have to apply all these sutures, it is very tricky and sometimes it becomes difficult. And someone from our participants suggested that we must continue these type of videos and demo on every month. I think I endorse strongly because it is really required and needed. Thank you very much, Professor Shahida. And now we will proceed to our and Faculty of Gujarat. Excellent work. Really, I'm really impressed by the Faculty of Gujarat. So we will move to our next session, our next part. Professor Huma Quddusi is busy. So I would love to ask Professor, I invite Professor Farisa Vakkar for questions and answers. And we have just right now one question. And if Professor, Madam, this is Madam Farisa Vakkar. Can you hear me, please? Madam, are you here? Yes, Madam, there's a question. Is vertical suture better than V-Lange in efficacy?
It depends on the situation, you know. If you already have the patient open for a cesarean section and the patient has atonic uterus, it's better to apply V-Lange like that. And if it's a normal delivery and then after that there is atony of the uterus, then the vertical stitch can be applied.
Okay. So up till now, we have only this one question, Madam. So I would like your comments and about everything and you have a huge experience and work on this PPH. So please put some light on this PPH, its management and treatment options.
First of all, I want to thank Sami Pharma for arranging this very, very important topic. I think many people have joined and it would be very nice that all these people, they take home take messages. How to manage postpartum hemorrhage. This is a life-threatening situation leading to very high maternal mortality of Pakistan. So then I want to congratulate Dr. Shahida Tara. She is always so dynamic, wonderful. And always, you know, she speaks very well. Dr. Shahida, my congratulations to you for an elaborate presentation on postpartum hemorrhage. You have not left any stone unturned for me to comment, but just few points on postpartum hemorrhage. Postpartum hemorrhage is a subject which is very close to my heart. And all my life, I've always thought, how can we prevent these deaths from postpartum hemorrhage, usually from delay, from lack of blood and blood products. And these women, you know, they die in front of our eyes. I remember the first day of my residency. It was the second day and a patient came and they said, Farisa, you delivered the patient. She was a primary gravida with a huge polyhydramnios and an anencephalic baby, not diagnosed till term. So she came, she was fully dilated. She just, you know, like, the baby came out into the bucket. And after that, to my horror, two of those samane mein sarkari hospitalon mein lohe ki baltiyan hoti thi aur usme wo do badi baltiyan khoon se bhar gayi itni der mein us waqt landline hoti thi. I called my assistant professor. She did instruct me by then the patient was in irreversible shock, and that was always, you know, it was a हार्ट एक फॉर मी ऑल माय लाइफ. मैं सोचती रही कि हम काश उस मरीज को बचा सकते. दैट वाज जस्ट माय एक्सपीरियंस. बट वी शुड वी ऑल नो दैट मैटरनल मोर्टैलिटी ऑफ पाकिस्तान एज डॉक्टर शाहिदा सेड 27% ऑफ मोर्टैलिटीज इन मैटरनल मोर्टैलिटीज आर ड्यू टू पोस्टपार्टम हेमरेज. Whereas in the Western world, the commonest cause of postpartum hemorrhage now is hypertensive disorders in pregnancy and not postpartum hemorrhage. But we are still struggling with postpartum hemorrhage. just a few points which I thought I would like to share with you guys. One is, but another definition of postpartum hemorrhage is that postpartum hemorrhage can be due to any amount of bleeding, not just 500 cc, which leads to hemodynamic instability in the patient. For example, a woman who already has a hemoglobin of 5, for her, if she loses even 200 cc of blood or 300 cc of blood, she can have exsanguination of her system and go into shock. So that is one point which I really wanted to point out. Then anemia. Anemia is something which is 90% of our population is suffering from, mild to moderate to severe degree of anemia. We can treat it in our clinics, in our OPDs. Majority of patients who are attending OPDs, they have anemia. And if we are very vigilant, jaise hemoglobin 9 ho, even if she is 28 to 29 weeks pregnant, please give her intravenous iron, just to ensure compliance. Because the problem with iron is that these patients, they take iron and they are non-compliant because of dyspepsia, because of irritable, bowel, they have irritability, then they may have diarrhea, they may have constipation. So they abandon taking iron. So please make sure, give them even if the hemoglobin is 9, don't wait for the hemoglobin to fall to 6 or 7. So even at 9, at 28, 29 weeks, just give intravenous iron sucrose so that the hemoglobin is built up by the time they deliver. Then these patients, uterotonics. Misoprostol is an excellent uterotonic in the latest, I think in the last 15 years or so, it has come into the market. And it has done wonders. Even people in the village, the tradition birth attendants, all they have to do is maybe give oral or vaginally or per rectal, they can give misoprostol and save these patients from developing postpartum hemorrhage due to atonia of the uterus. Then I want to comment on ergometrine. Dr. Shaida said we can give ergometrine. Yes, it is recommended. Of course, not in hypertensive patients, but is ergometrine available in Pakistan? Such a cheap drug, so effective, and it is not there in the market anymore, which is very, I feel really sorry. Such a good drug has vanished from the market. I must talk about morbidly adherent placenta. Morbidly adherent placenta is, it's a horror of present day history. Due to increased rate of cesareans leading to morbidly adherent placenta, I've seen it even in a second cesarean, that the patient developed major placenta previa and placenta percreta. And we had no choice but to do a hysterectomy to save her life. So I think we should all work at reducing cesarean rates. As the cesarean rates are going up, even women, they herself by choice, they want to have a cesarean section and they don't think of the consequences in the future. So that should be our aim as obstetrician. And as member of SOGP, I must emphasize on the fact that we must, try to reduce the cesarean section rate as a team, as a whole nation. We should do that and try to, reduce the rate of postpartum hemorrhage and hence due to it. Postpartum hemorrhage in the Western world, the incidence is 2%. But if you noticed, Dr. Shaida presented 5 to 7%, and that is higher than other areas of the world. I think the main reason are two. One is lack of education, then anemia, and finally, because of patients having grand multiparity. That is the reason for having a postpartum hemorrhage. Then I must comment on women's trial, which was conducted in Pakistan, and my hospital was one of the members of the woman trial, in which 1 gram of transamine, which was given to women, did reduce the amount of blood loss, and therefore postpartum hemorrhage can be prevented by just giving simple measures such as transamine and uterotonics, uterine massage. Even these small measures can reduce your postpartum hemorrhage by 50%. And finally, if a hysterectomy is allowed, is needed in postpartum hemorrhage, please do not delay it. If the patient's family is complete, she already has 3 to 4 children, don't waste your time on B-Lynch suture or on uterine tamponade. Do a hysterectomy so that a timely decision is made before the patient goes into irreversible shock and she develops DIC. The patient is saved and her life is saved. So thank you very much. I have given my elaborate comments, and over to the moderator. Thank you so much. Yes, Dr. Naila, you can take over.
Elaborated answer. But now, as you know, there's a, where is this one? But there is a question that, is there any role of vitamin K3 and transamine in prevention? So I think in the trial center, you have already answered. Would you like to say something about it? Role of vitamin K3 and transamine in prevention?
In the women's trial, which was conducted throughout Pakistan and in UK, we were part of that trial, and it was proven that by giving transamine 1 gram, you can reduce blood loss due to postpartum hemorrhage and reduce amount of blood which is transfused to these patients. Because, you know, blood is not easily available, blood products are not easily available. So it does definitely have a role. And vitamin K, yes, because vitamin K, if you give on time, it will reduce DIC occurring because of excessive blood loss and because of loss of coagulation factors in these patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Professor Fariza Waqar. Now I am honored that Professor Ghazala Mahmood had joined us, and she's here with us. Madam had done a huge work, a lot of work on PPH. She also conducted a survey on maternal mortality in Islamabad Capital Territory. So I will request Sami Fama, if we can take Madam for the next question and answers and for comments. Please, Sami Fama, can we add Professor Ghazala Mahmood with the permission of the chair for some question, answers and comments?
Yes, of course, it will be our honor to hear from her. Thank you.
And Dr. Ghazala is already a part of panelist. She can
really
share her video, and yes, I think she's a speaking.
She's here.
Madam,
she's
can.
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam, Madam. I welcome. Really, it's an honor, and you have just made this webinar very heavy with your presence. Thank you for coming, Madam. So before your comments, I would like to take put some questions to you. Someone from the participant asked that this uterus is very soft at the time when it is the baby is delivered, so it is difficult to put B-Lynch at that time. Number two question is, Madam, that by the use of this B-Lynch and uterine artery embolization, what are the effects on future fertility? Thank you, Madam. Thanks a lot for joining.
Thank you very much. The first question, the uterus is soft. Well, the uterus is soft when it is pregnant. And I think this B-Lynch suture has been applied with successfully in the soft uterus. So that does not become that is a challenge which I think each and every one of us has to face, and people do face it. I don't think we should not be doing a B-Lynch where it is required. And moreover, when the uterus is well contracted, it becomes firm. So I think that softness goes into the firmness, and hence we can put in the B-Lynch suture. So that's the answer to the first question. Your second question regarding this, the effect of the B-Lynch and uterine artery ligation or embolization on fertility. I think it is well known that uterine artery embolization affects fertility, because we do know that the blood supply of the genital tract is so vast, and a number of sources contribute to the broad ligament and the blood supply to the cervical, the uterine, and the ovarian vessels. All the three vessels from different sources, they come on the right and the left, so on either side of the uterus. And for immediate stoppage of hemorrhage, one can ligate, but I think fertility after ligation is restored when you do it in the B-Lynch or in the uterine artery ligation. But for the uterine artery embolization, the blocking material, it can enter into the ovarian vessels and can cause a loss of blood supply. And we do know when the blood supply to the ovary is interrupted permanently, an alternative source is not available, it can decrease the ovarian function and ovarian reserve. Does that explain what you want to know?
Yes, madam, I think. Now there is no next question. So I would like to have some comments.
Just one moment. I was just sure. Want to say that uterine artery embolization leads to loss of ovarian function in 1% only. Sirf 1% chance hai ki aisa hoga. Otherwise, I'm putting exact statistics. Thank you.
But you can't predict. But you can't predict which 1%. That's the problem.
Okay, thank you. Madam, I would love to ask some comments on PPH and our webinar, and what about the topic. The faculty of Gujarat did very well, so I need a brief comments about it, and then we will meet for the conclusion. Would you like to give some comments on it, madam?
Sure. Thank you very much, Rubina, for giving me this time. And thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, Shaida, for this excellent initiative. And I think this is the way forward for bringing the maternal mortality down from hemorrhage. Unfortunately, hemorrhagic deaths in Pakistan have not changed over the last two decades, as far as I can recall. There are different reasons for that, but I think our younger generation, that is your generation, is really doing a very good work, because this activity is going on in each and every region of the country. And my congrats to you and the sponsors, Sami Pharma, who have supported this activity. I think more needs to be done, as Naila was saying earlier. Now, to sum up, I have three messages to give to all of you. Number one, we must keep in our mind that postpartum hemorrhage is the leading cause of maternal mortality in our country. So each and every student, undergrad or postgrad, must contribute to this training. And I would request all the teachers and professors to train the undergrads in these essential workshops, in the form of a workshop, as you depicted here, for the undergrads, so that the message goes far and wide, and they are your workforce. No matter what specialty they take on, they are basically doctors. They should contribute to the community in our country, no matter where they are. So I feel the postgraduates can be taught about the surgical management, but the primary management of a case of postpartum hemorrhage, especially prevention. We have stopped stressing upon the prevention. We must teach them how to prevent that and the high risk factors. I had always found the high risk factors, if we carry out prevention in those cases, now we are able to save ourselves from the biggest hassles. And I tell you, transferring a patient is not an easy thing. And we do know that the golden hour, we must not forget the golden hour, the first hour immediately after delivery, if we are able to control the hemorrhage in that first hour, then we have done our job very nicely. So if someone is working in a peripheral hospital, you must teach them not to send the patient to the secondary hospital. There should be a direct referral to the tertiary level, and what actions to be taken before the transfer. It's extremely important that we tell them how to prevent blood loss, and which can involve even packing, and we don't have so many other facilities like this, the balloon which we use for this, not the balloon, I'm talking about those, the garments which are being used for transport, but I think you can try and get those on board. Rubina, mashallah, you are very influential, and I think if they are available in our peripheral and district hospitals, you would be able to save a few more mothers from this severe disease. So I, in my own practice, I have always given extreme importance to prevention of postpartum hemorrhage, to the active management of third stage of labor, and then taking quick decisions. And if there is a high risk for, as you all do, for postpartum hemorrhage, make all the things available on the table before you start working, which means RCC, platelets and FFPs. So I think these things in time, the time is of the greatest essence in these things, and we should be able to manage these cases. And I hope the misoprostol regimen, and I do agree with the Farisa regarding the availability of ergometrine and methergine, because I have always found it very useful. And I have done a study in PIMS where the incidence of postpartum hemorrhage went up because in the cesarean section population. And I did bring it down again by just giving one ampule of ergometrine. Please try read that study. That paper has been published in, I think, some 7-8 years ago in the JCPSP. I must thank all of you for giving me an opportunity to talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you. And it was really nice to have you with us. So now it is really very impressive that just at that time of the Saturday evening, there are so many participants and everybody is interested and asking the questions, and they want to know, they are happy with the contents of this webinar. Before proceeding to Madam Rubina Suhail for conclusion, I know she has so many things to tell us, so many things to just to tell us and to teach us. Madam, there are some things which sticks to your mind and heart always. There was a survey conducted by an American NGO at Balochistan, and they were questioning the mothers, pregnant mothers. The one pregnant mother answered to them that, "I think I'm pregnant again. And I don't know who will die this time, me or my child. Really, whenever I think about this thing, it gives me goosebumps and I really get scared." So this is the real situation of maternal mortality in our Pakistan and how we are losing mother. So madam, now the next, this is for conclusion, I move to Professor Rubina Suhail. Please, madam.
Thank you very much, Naila, for conducting the session so beautifully. Shahida, for giving a very good presentation to set the ball rolling, and the support team from Gujarat who demonstrated the skills very adequately. And the cherry on the cake was the presence of Professor Ghazala Mahmood. I love to hear from her when it is a talk on maternal health, and she has got so much experience. She actually infused me with enthusiasm to do more regarding maternal health, and hearing from her has been a real pleasure for me. I'm going to talk about it in three areas. The first thing, I think the most important thing to me is, and many of you have really pointed it out and highlighted the problem of anemia in Pakistan. Naila especially mentioned it, Farisa mentioned the incidence of anemia in Pakistan. So I would just like to share with you what we are doing in Services Hospital. So we made it our policy a couple of years ago that no woman is going to deliver who has booked with us is going to deliver with a hemoglobin of less than 11. And following that policy, we started screening our patients, and we would screen them at 28 weeks. If at 28 weeks there is any pregnant woman whose hemoglobin is less than 11, we select them for injectable iron, provided there is no thalassemia. And we calculate the dose of iron that is required for them, and we call them and we make sure that we build up their hemoglobin. This policy has really paid off to us in a couple of years' time. Amongst our book patients, we really have to struggle to find a book patient who has got a hemoglobin of less than 11. So I think that this is easy to do, and all our units can do it. And with the presence of more and more safe iron products available, I think we can manage it even in government hospitals. And when we started, the hospital administration did an audit of our department because so many number of iron ampules were being used in our unit that they thought that they were pilfered. And I think that this is important, and we can do that easily. The second thing which is very important is an early diagnosis. So we have to make sure that our team of doctors are aware of the fact that in every woman that they deliver, whether it is a PPH or not PPH, they have to do a visual assessment of blood loss. And if they are in the habit of looking at the amount of blood loss, then diagnosis of PPH will become easy and early management can be instituted. So for example, what I do is, and I keep on quoting examples from myself because I think that I'm as good or as bad a doctor as all of us. So if little things can be done by one person, everybody can join hands and share their experiences and make it even better. So if by the time I start doing the episiotomy and the bleeding is still more than what it should be, my antenna goes up. And if I complete my episiotomy and there is still bleeding, I declare it as PPH and start the management. So I think that it is very important to do a visual estimation of blood loss and start early management. The third thing which Shahida emphasized was that the management has to be robust. It has to be a robust management, and it has to be a team effort, because one person cannot manage the patient of PPH, and it has to be many people combined. And a very important question was raised in the question answer box, which was about audit of maternal mortality. And I think that the next session that SOGP needs to do, and I'm willing to help in that, and I know a couple of people who will be very happy to join in, to talk about maternal mortality audit. How can we do an audit? How can we identify where we went wrong? How can we be non-punishing type and identify our mistakes and correct them and make sure that we help each other in improving ourselves? So I think that audit is the need of the day. And second thing that I would like to share is, and I'm sure many of you know, Professor Ghazala, I'm sure would know about it, that FIGO is doing a project on FIGO PPH bundle approach. And FIGO PPH bundle approach project is, this time it is also a SAFOG project, and it is being carried out in Bangladesh. We did try to do it in Pakistan, but because of certain issues, we could not get hold of FIGO to get it for Pakistan as well. But this is being done in Nepal. It is being done in certain places of India. It is being done in Bangladesh. Now, the concept of PPH bundle approach is, it's actually three-pronged. So there are two bundles. One bundle, or the first bundle, is the primary response bundle. And in primary response bundle, there are included uterine massage. So basically, we are talking about uterine atony over here as a cause of PPH. So the PPH bundle approach is more focused on the atony component. So uterine massage, the use of uterotonics, use of transamine, the use of isotonic crystalloids, these four components form the primary responds to PPH. If the PPH does not respond to these four measures, then the next three measures are the compression measures, like the aortic compression or the uterine compression, then intrauterine balloon tamponade, and the third is the non-pneumatic anti-shock garment, which Professor Ghazala Mahmood was referring to. So these are the two components of the bundle approach. Now, what the bundle approach has done for us is that it has organized things in a more efficient manner, and teams are trained to manage these patients by the bundle approach to make sure that women do not die. Now, in addition to these two bundles, it has got a general, which is a non-clinical component, and the non-clinical component is about communication. It is about advocacy. It is about teamwork. It is about training of our doctors and the midwives, and it is about the use of best clinical practices for the management of PPH. So nowadays, I'm reading a lot about PPH bundle approach, and I hope to very soon, with the help of SOGP, start a campaign so that we can, I don't know if I can use the word eradicate or not, but we can save the life of the mothers at least dying from PPH. Because, you know, Pakistan has got so many issues that every time you get hold of an issue, you talk about contraception and you say that contraception is the biggest issue. We talk about PPH. PPH is the biggest issue. But I think that for today's webinar and with the participation of very senior consultants from all over Pakistan, I think we can join together in this endeavor to put the PPH bundle approach in practice, even without the support of any donor or any developmental partner, because this we can do with very good people in the pharmaceutical industry like Sami Pharma, and I would like to thank them over here, that this is the way that we can take it forward, teach the skills to our trainees, talk about communication, talk about teamwork, because teamwork is lacking. As soon as PPH happens, all of we are sitting here are working in the labor room. What is there? There's panic. If you diagnose PPH early, there's actually no reason to panic. And a balloon tamponade can put in, like, actually it takes hardly less than a minute to put in a balloon tamponade. And there is no harm in doing it early rather than doing it late. So some people keep on thinking, really, do I need to do it? It is a simple skill. A vaginal delivery, uterine atony, not responding to myso and oxytocin. Why do we need to wait? Just put in the balloon tamponade and it's easy to do. Use of transamine is easy to do and should be a part of the routine practice. And my question to all of us is transamine available in our delivery rooms? So if the answer is no, it should be converted into a yes. So working together, doing little things, we can make sure that PPH can be prevented and managed in many of the cases. And as Naila shared the story of this lady from Balochistan, who said, I don't know whether I'm going to die or my child is going to die. So we can at least ensure that the mother is saved, and we can join and become a part of it. I think with these lot of comments, and Naila has been very patient in listening to my comments, I would like to end over here thanking each one of you for participating, bringing the topic forward, making sure that the importance of the topic is highlighted in a very, very efficient manner. And also making sure that we work together to make sure that all the 24/7 facilities in all the provinces of the country have the ability to manage PPH. This is one thing that they should be able to do on their own. Then there should be need for referral, but referral should be done of a patient who are in a good shape, and not a patient who's going to die at your doorstep without receiving any help. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Rubina Suhail. I was really enjoying your comments and everything. Anyhow, it was a very excellent meeting, and we have learned so many things from Professor Farisa Waqar, by Professor Shahida Hussain Tarar, by you, madam, and by the Professor Ghazala Mahmood. Now, as the session had been completed, I will move to Professor Halima Yasmin. Madam, it was just all credit goes to you for this awesome webinar, and as a general secretary of SOGP, it is just all your efforts. To my mic is given to Professor Halima Yasmin for vote of thanks.
Thank you very much, Madam Naila. Thank you very much for moderating the session so well. This was a topic which was really much needed at this moment, I guess. And the panel, the speaker, the presence of very senior audience has done the justice to the topic. I'm really hopeful that through this discussion today, we are all again geared up with energy, and inshallah, as Madam Rubina said, Madam Ghazala said, we will definitely work on the evidence-based approaches of whether the bundle approach or a teamwork approach, the collaboration. We can never underestimate the power of these game changers. And inshallah, SOGP is committed through trainings, through advocacy by people like you who are present here in the audience, among the speakers, among the analysts, to take this message forward so that we have a real army of trained providers taking care of our delivering women and preventing as well as diagnosing and managing the PPH as early as possible. Thank you very much. And at the same time, I'm thankful to the sponsors, Sami Pharmaceutical, for being very, very helpful to conduct this webinar. Madam Shahida Hussain Tarar for giving a wonderful talk. Madam Naila Israr for moderating the session well. Madam Farisa Wakar and Madam Huma, she couldn't join, but she committed and she came here. She was very active in the conversation, but she couldn't join today. Madam Farisa, thank you very much for joining and for giving your comments and answering all the questions. Madam Ghazala, your presence and then your comments as well as answers to the questions really helped us to add value to this webinar. Madam Rubina, you really concluded it the manner we wanted and the way we look forward towards your comments always. And all the audience here, and especially the faculty from Gujarat who sent us their skill session video, they did it very well. And I'm hopeful that this webinar would be a help to the trainees as well as to the providers generally nationwide. Thank you for being there to hold hands together with SOGP. We are all SOGP and we are working together for the welfare, for the well-being of our women and the children, inshallah. Thank you again.
Thank you very much. So with this session is ended. Sorry, madam. Thank you very much. Thank you. Love you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.